Meteorologist Pedram Javaheri is here with us right now. Okay, so with Dave, we've been talking hour after hour, unfortunately, about these rains. We've already been so lucky, haven't we? Because
really
the monsoon
have.
Rains haven't started.
It's incredible. You know, we get a lull, 4, 5, 6 days of very little rainfall in one of the wettest places on our planet in the heart of the wet season. So that's remarkable in and of itself. We know that luck is coming to an end very quickly. So, of course, folks know how serious the next several days have to be as far as getting the amount of work done and hopefully rescue efforts underway again when the rain here before it picks up in intensity. Let's show you exactly what's happened over the last several hours that we're seeing the shift in this monsoonal pattern. Of course, this is not a single storm. It's not a single event. The wind's now entirely shifting from the east, pushing back towards the west. Northern areas of Thailand, that's where the heavy rainfall is expected to really pick up. And back on June 23rd, very little rainfall. The next day, almost no rainfall came down. And then a couple days into when the boys were trapped down in the cave, you see tremendous rainfall. And then, of course, things have really dissipated. The pattern we expect to return to what we've seen in those initial days when the boys were initially trapped there, and of course the water filled the caves. And you notice each and every single afternoon over the next three afternoons we get thunderstorms that develop. This is a telltale sign of the monsoons really taking shape, and the forecast brings just a couple of millimeters by this afternoon and this evening, not a tremendous amount just yet. So really Monday becomes a key day as we go in towards Tuesday, say 11 a.m. noon, 1 p.m. Tuesday, and then through much of the afternoon some heavy rainfall is certainly expected. The highest amounts come down on Wednesday afternoon, and these 3 days alone would be the three wettest days so far in the first 16 that these boys have been trapped in this cave system. And in fact, when you take a look at that, maybe not seem like a lot of rainfall, 60 millimeters in a span of 3 days, but take that down, bring it down onto a soccer or a football field, that would equate, even just 60 millimeters would equate to 500,000 liters of water over an area just the size of a soccer field. The reason I say that, it's about 12 and a half swimming pools, but the reason I say that, you accumulate that amount of water, you funnel it into a channel, into a cave system, it becomes a tremendous amount of water to work with, not just 60 millimeters to work with, and that's what's concerning across this region. Notice over the next 7 days, potentially as much as 150 to 200 millimeters could come down. And of course, the landscape across this region, very mountainous near the cave entrance, all of that water will want to funnel downstream. And Paula, when you look at that and you try to think about how much water that is, just 60 millimeters turning into 500,000 liters of water over just a football field size area. And then of course, there's a lot more of that area than just one football field. There's millions of liters of water that could once again funnel back in there quickly.
And no way to predict exactly where that water's going
exactly.
Inside that cave system.
Yeah.
Okay, Pedram, we get it. 24 to 48 yeah. hours, very crucial right now. Thanks so much. Appreciate it. Now, bringing out the first four boys was quite a victory in and of itself. Our Tom Foreman looks at how the first rescues took place.
The initial part of this rescue actually happened a little bit faster than officials expected, with two boys coming out about 10 minutes apart, then 2 hours later, two more coming out. And that was possible only because of a massive effort to pump out so much of the rainwater in this cave that some portions of it became walkable. Now, other areas still remain completely submerged, and that's why these divers had to go in there and put these boys into full face masks. There were 18 skilled divers in the cave at this time, and as they brought them out, they used this configuration. A diver would go up front, tethered to the boy behind him, carrying the air supply for that boy behind him. They're all following a line, and then another diver would come there backing up the entire effort. How many parts of the cave did they have to do this? It's not really clear from the maps as we can see them so far. A lot of the cave clearly is still submerged, but we don't know what that means. By some accounts, it's a quarter of it, which would be around a kilometer, which is maybe 11 football fields that they had to go under, completely submerged with no vision, bad currents, cold. That's a huge ask for kids who've never even been in scuba gear, and yet they managed to get four of them from in there out here. And now they have to get the others. First thing, they've got to replenish those oxygen supplies because they've used up everything. They're starting all over. That's going to take some time, but they don't have a whole lot of time. Look, all of the pumping effort has been aimed at the rain that collected from the time the boys disappeared. They've had a little lull in here, and now the monsoon rains are coming back in earnest. And that is giving an urgency to this effort beyond even what we have seen so far.